Smitty, can you talk? That's kind of cool. I'm not used to Smitty being here. I'm gonna be on pins and needles all day. The chicken farmer extraordinaire.
He said he can't hear anything, but that may be on his part.
That may be on his part, right? All right, Smitty. Take it off mute or something. Everybody else can hear, right? We're good. Only in America.
Yes.
Does that get y'all fired up? Look at Rick. He's all fired up. Only in America, baby. You know, the more I think about it, they're trying to make us all hate each other, but dang, it's a good country, isn't it? It really is. Compared to, I mean, we could be living in, I don't know. I don't want to hurt anybody's feelings, but we could be living in Canada for the love of God. Oh, my goodness. Those silly Canadians. All right. Well, Smitty, I hope you'll be able to hear at some point. Let's see. Today is Wednesday, April 28, 2021, 12:04, and life is doing so good. And let's get into it. Let's see what the market's doing. And, well, first of all, let's just look. This is the 15-minute opening range, right? Here's the cash open where it says cash. Here's VWAP. So the market's really just kind of a nothing burger so far, right? Why? Do we know why? Because we got Fed stuff happening. Isn't Jay Powell talking today? He's going to be, talking. We got minutes coming out. We got all this kind of stuff, right? So, you know, we're not really worried about him. Normally when he speaks or does something, the market goes down. So we're down just a tad, and we're just kind of, you know, just kind of marking time. Hey, Dwayne. Dwayne's coming in. Ken's coming in. Hey, so y'all like, Ken, I saw your comment on the video I shared last night. Yeah, I thought that was pretty good with that dude, if y'all hadn't had a chance to watch it. Ken said you need to watch it at least twice. Ken, what were your takeaways from it, from the video?
Well, it confirmed my thing. Is like on the, what you call the Cameron Skinner trade, I can't go out this far because of the nature of my accounts. You know, where, I've already got the other things set up, so I don't want to mess with that. So I only have so much buying power. And then I was toying with the idea, well, instead of buying one every day, selling one every day and taking one off every day, well, what about Monday, Wednesday, Friday?
Yeah.
You know, and then that helped, but it didn't help enough. And I said, well, let's do it twice, and then let's do it weekly. And that's what he was saying in the end, you know, do as you can. And I like the idea of, you know, he took the Tasty trade 45-21 and idea, and he do it, you know, and all you need would be seven. All you need is buying power for seven spreads, and that'll get you going. And you can improve on that as your equity builds up. And so I like that. Also, you know, he was, and the second big takeaway was he put it in perspective about risk, and it made it seem easy. Of course, you know, that's the danger when someone makes it seem easy. But I did like it, and it's sound. Everything was sound, and it was the voice of experience.
Yeah, and the cool thing is, you know, it's similar to the trades that we do, right? You just kind of put them on regular intervals, and then you take them off and manage them. So yeah, anything that kind of confirms, you know, that we're kind of on the right path is good. You know, we're learning together. We always try to, learn, use the best research that is out there. You know, I'm not doing the back test of all these things, but I'm trusting other people that have done them. And I think what we do, managing our forest first, and then looking at the health of the individual trees is really, really good. So you go into a day, you open up your platform and you look at your Greeks, right? And that's what we do. We look at three or four different metrics and we change those metrics. The great thing about it is you and I can manage a $1,000 account doing this, or we can manage a $1 billion account doing this. I mean, I really believe that. Not that I've ever done it, but, you know, it's kind of like, it's a, you know, you can fly a glider in the air, or, you know, we can get on a jet, you know, one of Delta's jets, a Boeing 7, whatever, and fly it. If we know how to use the instrumentation, right? If we know how to use that, then we can just adjust and you know, and like Ken said, you get a larger count, then the frequency of your trades can increase. You can put on more. But if you're a small fish, then do it once a week. You know, do something once a month, whatever the frequency is that you can do on the campaign trades that we've got going on, then do that. But look at this. Isn't that amazing? This little pivot point, look, the market went right down to it, formed an alligator, and I'll be dang, she's going back up. And where's she probably going to go? I would imagine she's going to go back to VWAP, and she'll probably go back to that opening 15-minute range. And then she might go above it some to the overnight high from last night, which is 41.85. That's what that blue line means. I think this one, I got to look at all my lines. I think that's the overnight low, right? So we've got a tight little range. Well, not tight, 10-point range that we're just going to beat up, beat down until J-PAL speaks. And the bad part about it is a lot of times our theta just kind of holds, right? It doesn't burn away, and that's what we look for, theta decay, until the event happens, until minutes are released and he speaks. So we don't really get involved in that, right? Because here's the deal. I just rolled out of bed from a Benadryl-induced coma, right? I mean, dude, I was having some freaky dreams last night. I can't remember them all, but, man, I was in some weird situations. Then I go, oh, it's time to make the donuts. It's time to roll out of bed from the hangover of Benadryl and get it going. What's our chat say? Good morning, everyone. Hello, Peter. How you doing? Good to see you. So, yeah, welcome in. We're a little family here, Peter. So, good to see you in with us. Dwayne, Smitty, Ken, Rick, all of you, and Matt Jolly Wally. All right. So, let's get to going. Let's see what our net lick is. 51,766. 51,766. So, let's put it in. 51. What'd I say? 51,766. My slow old computer. You think with some of this money that I hadn't made since I'm $9,000 down, you'd think I would use some of that to make a computer purchase with a faster computer. 51,766.04, I think is what we were. So we are up $230.45. Oh my gosh, we're finally positive on the year. So all the haters and distractors can say, Bobby, you're lost $9,000. No, I didn't, you asswipe. Sorry, I should have said that. No sweet and sour Bobby today. It's all sweet Bobby. All right, so let's get back in here. All right, so now let's do our little Greekies. Sorry, y'all. I hadn't taken my medications yet. Y'all know what it does when I don't. All right, so let's get all of our stuff in. I'm going to tell y'all something. I look at Rick and I say, that is what I like to look like. I mean, just cool. Look, dude is just, Rick, you are poised. You're calm. You're confident. I mean, dude, I can't rock that. I just, you know.
Bobby, you just have to be you. And this is you. I am glad that you're you.
Well, I appreciate that, Rick. But I look at people and I go, that Rick is just cool, you know.
I'd be cool if I had a spam hat like you. I'm going to look for one.
You know, I looked on eBay the other day, and I found a pink one. And I told Beth, I said, Beth, let me get this for you. She said, I wouldn't be caught dead in that hat. She said, I hate that hat. She keeps threatening that she's going to throw it away. I don't know if y'all can see it or not, but this is the hat. Like when y'all see the sweat stains on it? I mean, I wear this everywhere. I wear this to church. And, you know, it's got all this. I'm speaking to a group of high school students Friday about the stock market, right? And, you know, my mama says, please don't wear that hat. Please don't wear that hat. And I'm like, why? That's my hat. I mean, God, I love my hat. And mama was like, please shave. Please cut your hair. So Beth cut my hair the other day, so I was real pleased with that. And anyway, I digress. Look at our theta, y'all. 309. Holy Shimon, what have we been doing right? We've been living right. We were 256 yesterday. 309. We're up money. We're up money on the year. We're not down $9,000 like everybody's telling me I am. Unbelievable. I let people get under my skin if y'all hadn't noticed. My Vegas positive. How much more can I do? How much more can I do? 132. Oh, this is the funnest stuff. Look at this. We are at theta of 0.6. Now, Peter, what we're looking at here is we record our Greeks every day, and we want this to be between 0.1 and 1% of our total net lick. So it gives us a green telling us we're good. So my theta is good. Theta is a measure of risk, and we don't want to take on too much risk. We've been closing trades to get our buying power under control, and that's what I don't want you to do. Don't freak if you're out of control in your portfolio in a day, right? Rome wasn't built in a day, neither was your portfolio. Just make little adjustments. So we're using 16,884 in buying power, so let's lock that in. Oh, and not that y'all will ever read it. What, 16,684, something like that? 16,884, I forget. But I will provide. I'm gonna provide y'all with a copy of my dissertation once my final edits are made. And I'm willing. And I want y'all to read that about the Black Swan hedge. So I'll be sending that to all of y'all. And please, God, if you see a misspelled word or something, you know that you go, Bobby, this is terrible. Then send it. Let me know if y'all will prove. It's great bathroom reading. Or, you know, like you can't sleep at night. The best thing to read is the Bible, right? You put the Bible on and you go, man, I'll start reading God's word. I'll jump in. And next thing you know, boom, it knocks you out. Look at this, y'all. We are almost delta neutral. It says we need positive 3 deltas. Well, I think we can take care of that today. So everything looks good. Everything looks good. Peter, our spreadsheet tells us what to do, right? Because I am too dumb to have the discipline to do it on my own. All right, so let's go to our credit spreads. Credit spreads. And we're going to take another one of these puppies off. My Cameron Skinner trades. Where are we going? So this one's in for 30 days. Right? We're 613 points away. Wow. So that is the – come here, baby. Come here, darling. Come here, sweetheart. All right, here we go. So let's see what we're going to do. That's the 35.75, 35.65. I'll never remember with 30 days to go. 35.75, 35.65. So let's close it. Let's take some profits, baby. All right, here we go. So we open this up. What is this? The crap. News and portfolio. What the devil? Oh, my gosh. Apple poised for very strong. We don't even care about news, do we? We're not news junkies. We got better things to do. We got to play with the kids and the grandkids. SPX. 35.75. 30 days out. 35. Yeah, here it is. We're short to 35.75. Right? And we're short or long to 35.65. So let's close that. Only in America can you make money in the markets like we can without having the government tell us what we got to do. It's going for 15 cents. Please fill me at 15. I don't want to go to 20. Please, please, little market. The Nat is at 30. Give me a feel. Give me a dang feel. Hum, daddy, daddy. Hum, daddy, daddy. Nothing. Jack, squat, crap, heck, nothing. I have to close it for 20 cents. All right. I see how you be. Sorry, y'all. Unmedicated Bobby is a, what's that? 15? I thought, okay, put it in at 10. Let's try it at 15 then. Here we go. Get us out at 15. Give me a break. Give me a break. Pick me off a piece of that Kit Kat bar. What's y'all's favorite candy bar? Please tell me y'all like a Baby Ruth.
I used to like Butterfinger.
Now, why can't you? Is that a non-vegan now or something? You said you used to like it. You don't like it no more?
Yeah, it's got milk chocolate.
Oh,
I love milk chocolate. Yeah, I know.
Yeah. But I'm sure that you found a substitute, right? That there's something out there that's pretty good.
Well, Oreos are vegan. I like Oreos.
Oreos are vegan?
I like it. Yeah, go figure. Go figure.
Oh, I like that. Now, see, I'll get run out because some people will say this is not a bar, right? But a Reese's Peanut Butter Cup. I mean, let's just talk candy. Oh, my gosh, y'all. That's like my favorite. Oh, I love those things. Love them, love them, love them. So we got out of that for 20 cents. We're going to delete this stuff because that makes it a little hard on our spreadsheet.
So, Bobby, most of those Cameron Skinner trades, you went in at a short delta of 17, like 15?
Yep.
17, mm-hmm. Something like that.
Uh-huh. That's kind of where we found that sweet spot was, right? It was, you know, because he was going, what, 10% out of the money, right? So take the current market price, multiply it by 0.9, and we were finding out that that was pretty much the about that 17, 18 delta. Can't believe we paid 20 cents to get out of that. And because they don't tell us, let's see how much we got. So we got out for 20, and that cost us a debit of 22.26. So we're just making our little bucks, right? Making 22.26. So that means we brought in a profit of 55.48. 71% profit on that one. That ain't bad. So let's put our exit in, and then let's see how bad our week is. We're still down, right? Hopefully we're going to have a payday on Friday. We'll see. We'll see. Sun coming up on the LA freeway. I was watching 90 Day Fiancé the other day, and that Angela from Georgia, she's going out there to have her weight loss surgery. And I thought, Lord, LA will never be the same. For those of y'all that watch 90 Day Fiancé, I watch all these chick shows with my wife, right? All right, so we got us $55. Let's make this green so we know that's a winning trade. Look at all the green, baby. You know, SPX has been my best thing so far this year. Tell you what, how much I've made in SPX. Okay, so SPX trades, and we do a number of different ones, right? But let's see what it says. Year-to-date profit on SPX is $2,507.50. Our second biggest profit is our micro e-minis, right? That's $1,470.75. So those are really good ones. All right, so we got that in. All right, so let's go check and see how we doing. How we doing, baby? How we doing? Where's my cursor? Where's my dang cursor? There it is. All right, here we go. Weekly premium. So we're at negative $144 this week. Bobby, you say you're making $1,000 a week, but you can't. So shut up! Love it. All right. So our total premium profits this year is $11,037. That's awesome. So hopefully we'll have a payday. Let's see how our equities are doing really quick, like. Let's just take a peek under the hood. Y'all, we might have a payday on Friday. Isn't it kind of cool? We've never really lost on these things from week to week. I wonder why that is. I mean, some of these are short calls. Some of them are short puts. We might lose on one, but it's amazing how every week theta decay works, right? That's what we're doing. We're trying to knock that basis down, and we're trying to, oh, no, we run Peter off. He was like, this is a bunch of crap, man. I'm out of here. All right, so looks like we might have a payday if theta keeps burning like it's burning now. So that's good. We don't have on a commodity trade, but I tell you, I am very close to putting on my gold trade. My friend was sending me this morning, yeah, I made another 50% on my gold trade. I'm going to put another one out today. And he just keeps on rolling that gold trade in and making that money. All right, so here we are in our micros. Micros. Micro. Look at there, y'all. $102. That'll almost put, and look, that ain't too bad. That's our only call on the board, right? So I'm hoping that Jay Powell speaks today and the market goes down about 20 points. And I may just close this one today. I may close that old nasty call. But right now, we're going to close the 3,800 with 30 days to go. So let's go get it out of the way. Come here, baby. 3,800. Then we'll sell another one. See what our deltas are after that. All right. So, what, baby? What you got, baby? What you got, baby? Well, show me. Oh, my goodness. What is that?
Putty.
Wow. Look at that. You can stretch it and everything. Well, I'll be done. Do you get a toy every day after you get out of school?
Yes.
Best spending a lot of money on toys for that child. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm talking to something. I'm talking to myself. You enjoy it, baby.
Look at it.
I'm going to cancel Best credit
this
card.
This is an egg.
That's an egg.
You put it in an egg.
I see that. That's
a
sweet.
Sparkly slime. I do a sparkly putty.
Okay. Well, you have fun, baby, okay? Mm-hmm. Bless her little heart. Here it is.
$3,800. We did an A.
Y'all did A at school today?
Yeah.
Well, I'm glad it's May and y'all already working on the letter A. Hey, that's good, baby. A little behind, I guess. All right, I ain't even gonna work the price, y'all. I'm gonna go out at 11:25. Let's get it. She got you sight words. Uh huh. My kids are a little strange, y'all. I love them, but they some weird kids. All right, so we got out at 11:25. Notice that after I take that out, it identifies my next biggest winner in purple, which will be $88. So we got $11.25, right? So we made $102 or so on this one. Yep, $102. So let's go get this recorded and in the books for prosperity's sake. Come here. Come here, little daughter. 63%. How does daddy do it? Just put them on every day, right? Right, here we go. Let's exit the trade. I'm trying to think. Y'all give me some ideas. When I'm talking to the high school class on Friday, what would y'all want to know? I mean, what would you think a high school class in financial literacy would like to know about the stock market? Y'all got any ideas? I mean, I don't think I can go in there and whoop out some options on them and say, The delta of the theta vega and the gamma whamma is, you know, I don't think I need to put all that out on them.
Now, tell me about this group of people that have no experience with stocks.
It's a high school group. It's a financial literacy class, right? And so, you know, it's the high school students and they're taking, you know, class about, you know, how to manage a checkbook, how to open a savings account, you know, and I'm going to go in there and talk to them about the stock market.
Well, and I'm like, yeah, leave this stuff alone that we're doing.
Yeah, we don't talk about this, right? I mean, yeah.
When I was in high school, I went to a class on the stock market with 4-H Club.
Yeah.
After, and we played, in those days, you had newspaper, and we did a simulated account where we would buy stock, you know, based on what we read in the newspaper, and we kept track of it and, you know, and getting the winners and the losers. And we did a field trip to Merrill Lynch. Of course, that was then, and this is now, and things are virtual. But one of the things that a takeaway is you don't know where these people are, and they're probably at ground zero. And so I would talk to them about what the market is. And also, I mean, a lot of people, and there may be some people listening right now, they really don't know one of the functions of the market. And I'll give you my example when I explain things, especially short sales, to people like my wife who wonders, why in the devil am I interested in this stuff? And I call it the Snickers or the Milky Way, speaking of candy bars story. I'm a maker of candy bars. So what it is I need to manufacture my candy bar at 50 cents a bar in order to make a profit. So what I do is I go with using the futures market. I lock in the price of cocoa. I lock in the price, and I know how much I'm going to make, how much I need. So I lock in so many contracts of cocoa, so many contracts of sugar, you know, milk, dried milk powder is a commodity. I got my milk product locked in. Well, it's going to cost me electricity to run my plant. Well, I got a coal burner over there. We don't do coal futures, but I can go off and get electricity futures or natural gas or oil futures to hedge my costs for the electricity. And then there's transportation, so our gas. So I got all kinds of futures that I'm using to stabilize my price. And I'm able to make that candy bar for 40 cents day in and day out. I make 10 cents. That's when I sell it to the distributors at 50, and then you see it at the supermarket or whatever for a buck or $2 or whatever. You see, the purpose of the market is to keep things stable. And see, that will open up a few light eyes right there. And that's the reason your candy bar costs whatever it is, your day in and day out. That's why your jug of your gallon of milk costs the same thing day in and day out. Now, other factors are involved, like taxation and inflation, which inflation is a tax that drives the prices up over time. But by and large, is you're not going into Kroger's grocery today and spend $2 on a gallon of milk, and then tomorrow it's $6 a gallon. And then, you know, it's just it's stable prices. And that's what the market does, and it does it with stocks too, you know, for people's why do people have stock? It's they want an income from dividends. They want to have a retirement fund, a place to store money. I mean, what's the legitimate use? I mean, pension funds have these stocks in huge quantities to provide retirement income for their customers. You see, there's a great reason for the market to be there, or else we wouldn't know where we're coming or going. Each day to the grocery store would be an adventure, and so that's one of the functions of the market. You could talk about that.
Yeah, I like that.
Price discovery. How much does something cost? You know, and the best thing I've ever seen that explains how much something costs is price discovery, and that's something that drives people crazy. They say the market makers are out to get us, and the big boys are out to get us. The bid ask that you see right now is the price is fair and legitimate as determined by the market forces. And of course, it's dynamic and it changes. Most people don't get that. Most people think it's the rich stealing from the poor.
Well, and hopefully another thing I could do, you talk about price stability, is we could compare a country like Venezuela, right?
Yes.
Where inflation is totally out of control. Because here's the thing, y'all. We are raising a generation of teat suckers, right, off of the government.
And yeah, we're in deep trouble for that. That's my political rant of the day.
I just want the little devils to come out and go, dadgummit, you mean I can go into a market and, you know, trade and hopefully one day make money out of it, and I don't need the government to – you know, to do everything for me? Yes, little entrepreneur. That's what I want them to come out with. I want them to come out with, like, hey, man, I'm in charge of my financial future. So we'll see. I hope it goes well. You know, maybe a couple of them will do a paper trading thing for them. You know, that'd be nice to kind of take the class on and do a paper stock trading with them or something. You know, there's all kind of things they could do.
This is a hard thing to do because I spend about 0.1 seconds on fundamental analysis and I spend 2 seconds on technical analysis, you know, and the rest of it's probability theory. That's hard to teach. Yeah,
you know, and that's why I don't want to be too nerdy with them, because I know, you know, I don't want to go over their head. I want them to come out with a genuine excitement about the market. Let's see. Matt says, most people are scared to death of the market because all they hear is how dangerous it is and how much money you can lose. Exactly. And one of the things, you know, I feel like I ought to tell these kids is, hey, we, as your parents and grandparents, I apologize on behalf of your parents and your grandparents. Do you know why? Because we didn't let you have a BB gun when you were little, because you're going to put your eye out with that thing, right? Not only that, we didn't let you ride a stinking bicycle without a helmet. Oh my gosh. How many of you in here have ridden a bicycle without a helmet? They'll probably go, you can't ride a bicycle without a helmet, Mr. Bobby, because it'll kill. Well, you know, guess what? My kids ride a, now they got helmets, right? But most of the time they're riding it without it. And I don't go outside and go, hey, little JoJo, put on your helmet, you little goofy butt. You know, I'm sitting there thinking, you know, you got to assume some risk, right? And I know you can get killed on a bicycle. You know, you can get run over by a bus in Atlanta today. But what we've done is we've taught an entire generation not to take risk. And it's really, really scary, because it's the entrepreneur that goes out and leaves the cave and clubs the dinosaur on the head and brings it back to the cave to feed the family that keeps this country going. Oh, that's why I love supporting our little businesses. Now, I spend a lot of money on Amazon, but I really do a good job of trying to support local businesses. We went to a local little farm the other day and we got the freshest strawberries. I couldn't have got them in a grocery store like we did, just freshly picked out of the, you know, out of the fields. Bought two, what are those things called? Hydrangeas or whatever. And one of my darn Leadbetter dogs dug one of them up and ate it all up. I'm going to never buy a dog from a dang Leadbetter. So, you know, we've taught an entire generation to play it safe. And every one of you in here, without exception, has blown up an account. I dare say we've all done it. I've blown up numerous accounts. Why? I was taking risks. So when I blew it up, what did I do? Did I lose the money? Yes, but I didn't lose the lesson. So I go back into the market and I keep trading and learning, and I'm on a path of lifelong learning. And you are too. That's why you're here. It's not that I have all the answers, but it's that we as a collective group, we try things out and we take risk. I mean, we talk about Rick doing the Rick trade Monday, Wednesday, Friday. He's slapping that trade on, knowing that one day he may take a $2,000 loss on one of his trades. But you know what? 95% of the dang time, the man is going to make a profit. And will he have a setback one day? Of course he will, right? But then we even have hedges in our account. Rick's got one of the diagonals that we've got on that's providing a partial hedge. We take risk. You got to. I want my kids to be like, you got to take risk. Now, do I wear my seatbelt when I'm in my car? Yes, I do. Do I think that the government ought to force me to do that? No, I don't. It's my decision on how much risk that I should assume. When I had my accident in 2009, I had my seatbelt on, but I flipped over I-20 headed toward Birmingham over three lanes. If a semi truck had been behind me, I would have been clobbered, but I flipped for what seemed an eternity. I remember it now. I remember the smell. I remember the fury. I remember it was just in my face like this. And it threw me out of the car. The police officers, you know, when they were talking to me and interviewing me about the accident, they were like, dude, we don't know how you got out of a car. Have no idea. They said the windows were not broken. The door was not slung open. They said, here's what we think. It was an SUV, right? It was a Ford Expedition. They said, Mr. Gaines, we think that your body went over the first front seat, over the second seat. Now, y'all, I'm a big old guy, right? Over the third seat. And you came out the glass hatch, because the glass hatch, the glass wasn't broken, but it was flopping like this. We think you went over three seats and got out on your side. So I was on my stomach. My eye, I couldn't see out of one of my eyes. I was blind and I was gasping for breath. One of my lungs was punctured and the other one collapsed. And so I'm lying there on the ground and I'm just gasping. And I'm like, will y'all call my office and tell them I'm going to be late? And I tried to stand up. And they're like, dude, you can't stand up. My pelvis was broken. My spine was broken. My sternum was broken. My ribs was broken. You know, and then they get me into the ambulance, and I'm lying there in the ambulance. Now, this is what I don't understand. I probably told you this story before. So I'm lying in the ambulance. And I tell the woman, I said, I got to pee. She said, let it go, boy, let it go. So I peed on myself in the ambulance. Kind of embarrassing, right? And then I asked her, am I going to live? Because I was gasping. I couldn't breathe. I said, am I going to live? Now, what would you tell a person if they're sitting there and you see fear in their eyes and you think you're going to die? You say, yeah, absolutely. We're doing everything we can. You're going to be just fine. You know what she said to me? She says, I don't know. She says, we're doing all we can. And I was sitting there going, crap, give me a little bit of hope, right? So anyway, 6 months in a wheelchair, the whole nine yards. But I could have not had my seatbelt on and been killed, I suppose. But it came out anyway. I don't know how it dislodged or whatever. But, yeah, it's an amazing story. But we assume risk in driving every day. Now, I can't drive if I don't take my Venlafaxine because I remember my accident. So I have to be on medications that kind of keep me from, you know, from being subjected to that. But my gosh, we are Americans, dang it. And we get up in the morning and we don't just wallow and we don't just let people take care of us. We are self-providers. And we don't want to create a generation that is afraid to take risk. You have to put capital on the line to make your capital work for you. You are never going to have financial freedom relying on someone else. It's got to be us. And so when you see someone like Matt, who's starting out with a smaller account, but's working a second job, you know, directing traffic at the school to pick up some extra pennies so he can throw into his account, you got to take your hat off and say, dude, you are an American. And that is what your ancestors did, surely, right? Because a lot of our ancestors, you know, hopped in a boat and come across the pond to get to the greatest place on earth where they could have a chance at making it. Not a place where the government tells us what we got to do. We know what to do. You don't have to tell me to wear a mask or to not wear a mask. I get to make my own decision about me and my family. So I do wear one, right? I'm extra precautious, but that doesn't mean that I'm not going places. Heck yeah. I'm going to the top of the river, baby. I'm going to eat me some mustard greens and cornbread and coleslaw and some fried dill pickles, dang it. And, you know, you don't tell me that I can't go over the state line. You don't tell me. I'm a risk taker. I take managed risk. And all of us here have to do that. And never to a point to where we go, well, let's take money from the rich and give it to the poor. Jesus said that the poor will always be among you. There is no government program that will do away with the poor. Now, Jesus was much nicer than me, and he probably should have also said in the next sentence, the stupid will always be around you too. And ain't no program or government program you can get where the stupid people won't be there. Y'all, we are filled with stupid people all around us. But here's the wonderful thing. I still believe in the ingenuity of the American entrepreneur who gets up and decides they're going to have a little business and they make biscuits or they make widgets or they make whatever, and they go out even in this dang pandemic and try to make it happen. And now we've got workers sitting on the sidelines that are collecting unemployment that don't want to go back to work. And it's going to shut our small businesses down. So when I get an opportunity to stand in front of a group of people, I'm going to say, I'm sorry we made you wear your helmet. I am sorry we didn't let you have a BB gun. I'm sorry that we made you play soccer instead of football because we was afraid you was going to get a concussion, little Johnny. Oh, you can play soccer. You know, soccer is okay. Matt, that's not what you coach, is it, soccer? Please tell me it's not.
I coach track and field.
I'm more for that.
Some tennis.
That's right. And when Matt does that, guess what he's saying? He's not telling his little track and field people to listen, let the other guy go ahead. He's telling them to excel. He's telling them to win, right? Soccer is a communist sport, y'all. It was formed in, you know, all these ungodly little communist countries, socialist countries that, you know, love at the end of the day to have a 1-1 tie. Y'all, we don't do ties, dang it. We win, right? I mean, a football game should never end in a tie. We want a winner. Tying is for sissies. And so we go, well, little Johnny, I don't want you playing football because you're going to get hurt. So we move them into soccer, which is still a dangerous sport, right? So, I mean, if you like soccer, that's fine. I just, you know, I've always said, oh, man, the countries that promote it are not countries that I like. So, you know, that's why we never really have excelled in it in the United States. But now we're pushing more and more people towards soccer. The next thing you know, we'll be doing dang curling, right? I mean, we'll be like the national sport of the United States is curling. Isn't that that sport in Canada where they push that rock down and they take a little broom and they're sweepy, sweepy, sweepy? I mean, for God's sakes, what an embarrassment, Canada. We don't want that to be our national sport in the United States, for God's sakes. We want it to be something like baseball or football where you can get beamed by a 100-mile-an-hour fastball, where you can have Randy Johnson throwing and killing a parakeet as it, you know, comes in front of home plate. That's what we want. We want something that's dangerous, that we're taking just a wee bit of risk. So we don't want our kids to grow up to be pansies. That's why when my kids have a problem, I say, y'all take it outside. Y'all whoop on each other. Y'all beat up each other. You do whatever. But at the end of the day, we're the Gaines family. And the Gaines family, we stay together. Now, don't hit nobody with a blunt object. Don't kill them with an axe. Like my mama, her brother, when they were little, was going to show my mama how her daddy killed chickens. So he had an axe out and had her on the block and about to cut her head off when my mama all come out and screamed like a hyena to get him to stop. So I don't want him to go to that extent, but fight it out, man. I remember in fifth grade, one of the greatest teachers I had was Charles Ray Hendricks. He was a mountain of a man. Dude had muscles on him, and he was unusual because you didn't see big old guys teaching elementary school. So he was a fifth grade teacher. And when he kicked a football, my God, that thing would fly. He's the reason I'm an Alabama fan. He was an Auburn fan. But he said, I remember Eric Merle, Big E, come in one day and had his Alabama hat on in class. And Charles Ray looked at him and said, Eric, you know Bear Bryant don't wear a hat inside? And Eric looked at him and said, really? Said, nope. Matter of fact, y'all, if you look at Bear Bryant's last game as a coach of Alabama, he was in the Liberty Bowl, right? What is Liberty Bowl, Matt? And so he was in a dome. And, you know, I always had that checkered hat on, not on his last game because he was inside. Now, I'm inside going against it. But I thought, how great is that, that a coach has some standards? And I became an Alabama fan in the fifth grade. But you know what Charles Ray would do when students had issues with each other? Baby, we might be sitting there going 8 + 7 = 17. I know that's wrong, right? And all of a sudden, one kid raised his hand. He said, hey, old Joe Blow over there looked at me the wrong way. Charles Ray said, put your pens up, put your paper up, put your books up. Let's go outside. And we went outside. And you know what he did? He had two sets of boxing gloves. And y'all, you talk about the greatest days were when students would get in fights with each other. So he'd say, okay, y'all, don't kill each other, but give each other a big old whooping. And they would put on their gloves and they would go out and fight it out. And after about 5 minutes, if you've ever boxed, you know it's an exciting thing. I mean, you know, 3 minutes in a ring, I mean, it takes a lot out of you. So after about 5-10 minutes, they were finished and they put it aside. You know, one kid might have a little bloody nose or something, you know, snot all over the place. But we all went in and we was like, dang, if this ain't the best day of my life, because people fought it out. You didn't shoot each other. They didn't knife each other. They didn't, you know, but they took a few boxing gloves to the nose and it worked out fine. And then you got to think, well, if I have a trouble with anyone else, I'm going to go out there and get my nose bloody. So we didn't have fights a lot. We didn't have fights a lot because we settled it, by God. Right there in the playground yard at the school. Can you imagine doing that today? Can you imagine doing that today? So here's what you're to be committed on. Ken and Smitty and Dwayne and Matt and Rick, you are risk takers. You are flipping risk takers. And it's beautiful. Oh, you are the epitome of the American dream. Will we ever have the riches that we desire? I don't know about y'all, but I am rich already. Am I the richest in funds and money? And all? Oh, heck no. But I've got a wonderful family that loves me. I've got kids that don't listen to me, but I love them. I think about the blessings that you and I have. And it is a wonderful, amazing, amazing country and environment that we have that allows us to come in here every day and click a few buttons to make some money. Where else can you do this? And that's what I want those kids to come out with that day is that, hey, you want to start a business, but you're worried. You don't have a lot of capital. My God, I showed y'all account. You know, somebody give me $35,000 to trade. Bobby, trade it. Just trade it. Whatever you want to do. I believe in you. I'm like, I'm probably going to lose money. That's fine. Okay, just go with it. You know, it's crazy, right? So you're a high school kid that has a little bit of ambition, who is responsible, who shows up every day. How many days? Now, y'all think about it. How many days have y'all missed? It's not a lot. Ken has his priorities, right? Sometimes he's going to be with his grandkids, and sometimes he's got something to do with his wife, right? But Matt sometimes has to be away at work. You know, Dwayne has to be somewhere. Smitty's in the shop. You know, Rick has work that he'll be with us all the time in September. But by gosh, for the most part, y'all come here each and every day and watch us do the same dang thing over and over and over and over, and you're committed. So when you first saw that very first video that I put up, you know, you said, well, that's kind of cool. I think I'm gonna you know, latch into that. And y'all risk some of your hard-earned capital to come into this goofy room so that we could trade together live every day. And for the most part, y'all have showed up every day. How many times? I mean, Smitty's watching these things at 5 o'clock in the morning. He's watching the video. You know, if I don't post the video, he's like, where's the next video? And he's watching them. And you're committed to the process. How many days have I missed, right? How many days have you heard me, even on my colonoscopy day, for the love of God, you know, where you go, oh, I'll take that day off. We don't take days off. The market's open. We're here, right? What about, you know, When it's President's Day? Well, we trade futures too, so we're here. We don't take President's freaking day off, for the love of God. You and I are committed to the process. We are engaged in the markets. We didn't just say to somebody, oh, we took that last month, right? We studied that last month. We are engaged in this stuff. And it's a beautiful thing to be able to come to your computer and to do this every day and to trade. No inventory, no physical inventory. We have an inventory of trades, right? But we don't have to house them. We don't have to have an office with extra electricity. We don't have to have extra phones. We just got a stupid little Acer computer that needs to be replaced because it's so freaking slow. And we got maybe a screen or two, but you can do all this on your phone. Where can you do it at? At the beach, you can do it at the Wild Animal Safari in Pine Hill or Pine Mountain, Georgia. You can do it at Callaway Gardens. You can do it at Panama City Beach, wherever. And we get to come into the markets and strategically, not just, you know, throwing darts, but to come in with a strategy to rip money out of this market that would chew us up in a heartbeat. It's amazing. So that's what I want.
Preach it, brother. Preach it.
That's what I want those kids to come away with. It's a great country, and it's a great time to take calculated risk. And y'all do it, I do it, and you're committed. And it's up to us to teach the little kids and to teach the little grandkids, you know, trading. And it's to teach them not necessarily trading, but risk and risk management, right? But not to where we put them in a flipping bubble. Not so they, you know, just sit there like a baby the rest of their life. We want them to be self-sufficient. We want them to have more than we had. We want them to excel. And that's the message for those kids, right? And so what are we doing? You know, you and I are trying to do something really good here. And yet we've got trolls on, you know, YouTube. Des, who hates my guts. I have no idea why he hates me. You know, the man called me a liar. He said, you're lying about your Kemp. And I said, brother, put your money where your mouth is. $1,000, I'll pay if I'm wrong. You pay if I'm, you know, whatever. Got on there and showed him. He said, okay. And he paid $1,000, but he still won't leave me alone. I've got the receipt. I got a copy of it showing where the man gave me $1,000, but he still torments me and trolls me and says, Bobby, you're down $9,000. Hell no, I'm not down $9,000, right? I'm showing my account number. I'm showing everything. Anytime that I've made a deposit into the account, y'all know about it. Anytime I take money out, if I have to, you know, pay for some repair or whatever, you see me take it out. I hadn't taken out any this year, but you see the deposits, you see the money. And that's the unfortunate thing, is in this business, there's so many freaking shysters out there. I'm making $17,000 a week. I'm making $100,000. You know, bull crap. You're trading in a simulated account, paper account. You won't even show your dang net lick. You won't show actual trades, and you're just scamming people, trying to sell them a dream. Well, what is the dream? The dream is, this crap is hard. This is the hardest endeavor that I have ever taken, maybe except being a parent with some, you know, nefarious little kids who don't listen half the time. But this is hard, y'all. It's hard. And so, you know, what are we doing? Well, we're closing trades for profits. Do we have unrealized losses? Yes, but they're coming in too. They're all coming in. So you make $1,200, you make $15,000, not $10,000 a week. We make $1,600, we make $978, $1,800, $1,000, $1,200, $1,220. We're down $42. Yeah, there's times we're going to be down $1,200. There's times we're going to be down $700. But remember, you can tell where my lack of focus was. You can tell when Sweet Bobby was doing Goldman Sachs trades and I was doing ungodly other little trades, stupid stuff. And now we're coming back. So if we stay on our path and we're on a good path, right, we know that this number is going to be 25% by the time we end the year. It may be 30, it may be 20, but our premium capture on closed trades is going to be right at 25%. I know it. I know it. That's the probabilities. That's what the stats tell us. And I can tell you, at our current rate, we're going to have a profit of $21,000. Our yearly return at this current capture rate is 41%. Our weekly profits are going to be $413. Well, we're outdoing that of late, aren't we? We're doing that. We've sold $57,724 of premium this year. Y'all, if I were to tell, and this is just one account, if I were to tell anybody in Bowden, Georgia, that someone is selling $57,000 worth of options, they would say, what the crap is that? That's a lot. And on that $57,000, you and I have generated profits of $11,139.13. Isn't that sweet? Now, does that include $1,400 that I, stupid here, ding dong, got out of line and, you know, went for, you know, scalping when I got a little nervous and I went against the plan and I started thinking that I was Einstein and knew that the market was going lower? Cost me $1,440. That's what it cost me. Then we also have lost the VIX hedges, right? So we're down another, you know, $500 or so there. So we know that, right? But it's all on the table. We ain't hiding nothing. I'm the worst trader on planet Earth, but by God, I'm a risk taker, and you are too. That's what we do. We come out here each and every day. We go into this market. We know what to do. Now, I may be the worst trader on the planet, but I was even a worser, if that's a word, trader 10 years ago when I first started. When I first started saying, I got to look at every tree. And when I can remember, this is amazing. When I first started, I did a calendar spread. I was scared to death. I'd never done a calendar spread. And I lost $300 on a calendar spread. Heck, I lose that in a day now, right? I lost $300 on a calendar spread. It ruined my whole year. It really did. I looked at that one stinking trade and said, I will never do another calendar spread again because it lost me $300. Well, how dumb was I? I was looking at the tree. I was looking at a tree that was sick. And I should have said, okay, one tree, let's do another one. Let's see how it fits into the overall plan. Let's see how it fits into an overall strategy. Y'all, what we have developed here is a strategy that is so simple that really a third grader ought to run. Okay, we want to have positive theta. Is our theta positive? Check. Check, 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 check. We want to have, let's go see. Here's the only thing we need to do. This is not complicated. This is not rocket science. We want to have positive theta. What is theta? It's a measure of risk, but it's also the amount of money that we expect to come into our account on a daily basis, all things equal. And over time, we're going to collect 25% of this. So what's 25% of 33? $75, right? Right? So we should be having $75. Well, I'll be dang if we ain't made $89 today. The world is good, right? Because you're not going to bring in all of this. Now, Vega, what do we want this to be? We want it to be manageable. Now, I imagine most of you have negative Vega, right? Most of you probably don't have positive Vega because I got all these goofy trades in here that's getting that positive. We don't appreciate this until we have a crash. You just wait. You're going to love that we have mitigated your risk by having Vega at zero or slightly negative or even positive. It's beautiful. And then we say, you know what? Let's be market neutral. Let's be neutral. We don't want to be bullish or bearish, but let's just keep a tiny bit of positive or of negative delta just in case the market does tank. Now, this is beautiful. Oh, it's beautiful. So all you need is these three numbers to manage an account, plus knowing how much buying power that you're using, right? So we don't want to use ever over 50% buying power. So if you've got a $52,000 account, you don't want to use more than 26%. And I've even gone further than that, right? Look, we've got this thing. We were at 20 earlier this week. We're at 15,836. So we're right where we need to be, around 30, 32% of our buying power. So with one number, hold on, let me draw. I hadn't used my drawing too. I spent $25 on this, so I got to use it. So all you got to do to trade is use that, and this. Four simple pillars to our entire strategy. Now, Bobby, but you're doing diagonal spreads. You may do ratio spreads. You may do calendars. You'll do a jade lizard, a broken wing butterfly, an iron condor, a credit spread, all these crazy things, right? Okay. If you'll grasp this, these four little things, all the rest is gravy. Because I can show you, if you say, Bobby, here's what I need. I need positive delta, positive theta, and I need positive Vega. I can show you a trade that will do that. Or if you say, okay, Bobby, I need positive theta, you know, I want negative Vega, I want positive delta. I can show you a trade that does that. They're all the same thing. And what we do, options are all it. You can either trade a put or a call or a combination thereof. It's really simple. There's two things. There's puts and there's calls. We can trade those in a number of different ways. So I don't want anyone to ever get lost on, oh my gosh, the diagonal, what a delta is this? What? Listen, forget all that. You get this first. Look at the forest. Here's the forest, these four little things. Oh, it's beautiful. It's gorgeous. And then we'll take on the little task of putting little trees in your forest, right? So I planted Beth, what was those plants we planted? I can't remember. Hydrangeas. Yeah, we planted our beautiful hydrangeas. One of them hopefully still living, but the other one was either dug up by JoJo, my son, or by one of the Leadbetter dogs, right? So that tree is gone. So now I'm going to try to protect the other tree. So when you wake up and you see these four numbers, you know what to do every day. It is repetitive and it may be boring, but it is profitable if you'll do it. So you say, okay, what do I do to adjust my delta? There's a couple things that you can do to adjust your delta, okay? And to adjust your Greeks. Let's put them on here. Let me use my little thing here. Yeah, here we go. Oh man, this is gonna be good. So what are you gonna do? You open it up and you need a delta, vega, theta adjustment. All right, you ready? Here's the first thing I do. I close trades. Boom, right? I close trades. So if I need positive deltas, if I need positive deltas, then I will close negative delta trades. Think about it. If I need positive deltas, I could actually close some negative delta trades. That's cool, right? Which one? Well, I generally like to close something that's profitable. So if I need positive deltas, close a negative delta trade. Just do the opposite. The second thing you can do is you can open new trades. Right? So if I need positive deltas, positive theta, then I can open a new trade. What could I do? I could sell a put, right? I could buy a call. We don't really buy options, but you do something that gives you positive delta. And final thing that you can do is you can manage existing trades. Manage existing trades. Well, what the crap does that mean? That means rolling. Rolling out, rolling up, rolling down. But keep in mind, we're not of that ilk that believes that managing and rolling is, you know, keeping the dream alive. If you're rolling a trade, generally you're doing one and two. Rolling a trade is closing an existing trade and then opening a new trade, right? That's what rolling is. So we book the loss. If it's a loser, we take the loss, right? It counts against us in our spreadsheet. And then we open a new trade. But we know how to roll to manage our deltas. Y'all, here's the cool thing. We have at our disposal every tool imaginable to manage this thing. And you and I, your days of blowing out accounts are over, right? Your days of blowing out stuff are over. We know that if the market goes down 20%, I'm going to be okay. I've got hedges on, right? I've got a number of hedges. I've got negative delta. I've got positive vega. Vega is not going to kill me on the crash. So we have within our disposal every tool imaginable to make this a success. The only thing that could possibly get us off course is ourself, where we start doing the dumb stuff, where we start letting the human emotions of fear and greed come in, where I go, oh, the market's crashing, I need to sell futures or buy futures, and then we lose $1,400 because I think I'm Einstein. Or that I start going, I mean, I'm going to start trading Goldman Sachs. No, here's what I like trading. I like trading the S&P 500 through the micros, through the E-minis, through SPX. That's what I like. Now, I'll throw in the mini SPX, the X, what XSP, whatever we call it. I throw that in there too. We'll throw in the RUT. We'll throw in, you know, NASDAQ, some things that are market related. But we don't need individual stocks. We don't need those. Trade a market. Trade the overall market. That's what we do. And time is on our side. But Bobby, you're down 8,000. I know it, ding dong. I know it. And someone will post it today. Hey, Bobby, you said you made $1,000 last week, but you're down $8,700. The account's not down $8,700, you idiot. To paraphrase, well, Bobby, Jesus. Yes.
On that down 8,000, 8,700, whatever it is.
Yeah.
Well, is when you go look at your balances, your cash balance, you probably got $8,700 money that you that offset that. You know, when you sell options or you sell premium, that cash is not yours until you close the trade. So I suspect almost all that money there is sitting in your account, and those idiots don't know that that'll be offset. That doesn't faze me in the slightest to see that number. I mean, right now I'm $1,000 down, just like you are here. But yeah. I know it's waiting for me to close the trade.
It's waiting on these trades to be managed, right?
Yeah.
And what are we doing every day? We're taking off winning trades every day. So hopefully this number goes up every day because I'm going to be taking off winners. And the ones that are not winners are going to be managed. They're either going to be closed or they're going to be rolled. closed, or wrote. And how do I decide what to do? It's all based on four simple numbers: delta, theta, vega, buying power. Four simple numbers runs this whole camp. It's the simplest thing on earth, on planet Earth. Yeah,
you don't care about gamma so much because you don't let the trade get that close to expiration.
Yeah, I don't care about gamma.
Okay.
I don't care about gamma. Now, keep in mind, do we let trades go to expiration? I do. And I used to track gamma, right? I did not find gamma to be a trigger for anything that I did in portfolio management. Now,
that's good, because I watch gamma, and it just sits there and moves around or doesn't move around. I don't know what to do, with it. You know,
it doesn't bother me. Now, we've got an SPX trade that will go into expiration. It's a butterfly going on Friday, but I don't care, because all of those trades that go into expiration are all defined risk trades, right, Ken? So with a defined risk trade, you know, gamma's not that important. And on the naked trades, we're closing them out, you know, before they get to expiration. Now, we've got, you know, we let a couple of those calls go because we needed the negative delta at the time, but we're managing those. So, you know, I guess my spreadsheet scares people off because there's so many pages, and you could delete it down to about three or four that we use every day, right? The other ones is just me being bored. I'm bored. You know, I told Beth, now that I've graduated from school, you know, I said, I'm going to work on a book. You know, I said, I'm going to write a book, a book of funny stories. And she's like, is anybody going to read that? Will anybody buy that? I said, I don't care if anybody buy that. I said, it's stories of my life. And, you know, hopefully the grandkids and, you know, your descendants down will have, you know, a book. So that's what I'm going to do to occupy my time. Because you can't do this every day. I'm not going to sit here for 8 hours a day and watch this stupid market. I don't have to. Now, I've done that. Oh, man, I remember when I was in Scott Stewart's room. I don't know if y'all have ever been in Scott's room, but we were doing the zero DTE, and that dude has, like, you know, he's got the patience of Job. And I'd watch that little flag, and I'd watch the price get to my little flag on, you know, Tastywork. I was scared to death. I'm like, oh, man, we fixing to lose, you know, $4,000 in a day. And, you know, he'd be like, well, we lost $15,000 today. We'll get it back next week. And I was like, crap, man, we lost $15,000. I don't do that anymore. I'm not into that. I don't need the excitement of a market every day. Here's what you do. You come in here, you look at it at lunch, you make your adjustments, and you wait till tomorrow. You don't watch this garbage all day. I mean, what a life. What a horrible life. Can you imagine just sitting here all day, you know, watching this, you know, like, you know, paint drying? No, just give it a quick one. You know, make your adjustments. What do? Okay, how do you adjust? You close trades. You open new trades. You manage existing trades to get this all in line. Now, what if you don't get it all in line today, right? Like, I'm still needing a little positive deltas. I don't worry about it. We'll worry about it tomorrow. We made some adjustments today, right? You don't have to turn the battleship around in one day. So, man, if we can ever grasp what we have here, so simple. Don't let me overcomplicate it. I make things complicated, y'all, and I apologize for it. But it ain't nothing but delta, theta, vega, buying power. Those four things. We can manage any account. You can give me your account today, and I can tell you what to do based on delta, theta, vega, and buying power effect. And I got a feeling y'all can do it too. Remember yesterday? It was great. I was, you know, I hadn't taken my medicines yet, and I wasn't even recording my Greeks. And what did Rick say? Rick says, Bobby, record your Greeks. He knows. He knows the plan. Nobody comes in here every day going, what are we going to do today? It's all written out so simple. And let's just keep it simple. All right? Man, I get fired up. I could go another hour. Hallelujah. Glory to God. A colonoscopy hose is 10 feet long. I would need a vial of heroin and a fifth of whiskey to even look at the hose. Oh, Lord Jesus. And they ain't called me back to schedule it. And that's got me worried too, right? I'm like, oh, how come we couldn't do the total clean out? And I did everything I was supposed to. Best side, I didn't walk enough. Whatever. We'll get it done. And I'm a risk taker. Is it risky to take a colonoscopy? You dang right it is. But is it prudent to get your colonoscopy done to make sure you don't got polyps in your colon? Oh, heck yeah, it is. All right.
Dad, I'm going to show you
and hopefully you can dry them out and make a necklace out of them. All right, I could talk all day. That's Holden. Oh, he's so cute. What's he doing asleep? All right, so the baby wants to play. So I will see y'all tomorrow. Good session today, y'all. Good session.
Adios.
Bye, y'all.